Rob mentioned he'd had some experience in radio. We have three different radio formats in Australia. We have a wonderful national broadcaster, and as much as we might bitch and moan, a lot of the time I think it's pretty unique to have one station that actually, if you break on that station, is getting into every little regional, I was going to say testicle, that's not right, tentacle of Australia, and it is actually quite unique compared to other formats, and certainly when you start to look at the states. Triple J is that station. It's affectionately known as the youth station. Indie rock, alternative, hip hop, electro is your predominant kind of genres there. Radio National is, I guess, not so much the sister, but for adult contemporary, jazz, blues, country, folk, you're looking at that format. We do have commercial radio. As with Canada, it's really just a place where they play music in between a whole lot of ads. That said, you know, if you can get that amazing ad on commercial stations, it really, really does make a difference. And I think the good news you guys got today with the Trues just managed to get a commercial ad, which is pretty phenomenal. Community radio is incredible in our country. I think it's such a wonderful launching pad for certainly Australian artists, but I think for international artists. We've got Emma here, and she works for one of the great Sydney stations, one wonderful show in the Pines.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of specialist shows. So again, no matter what genre you are, there is a community station for you, and a community station in each state. It's in excess of 300-400, I don't know off the top of my head, but I think these guys will touch on just how valuable the community station setup is. And it's not also just about trying to get that valuable airplay, but I think they can be really useful if you are touring to really get into those regional towns and use for interview opportunities, and a number of stations will present shows and you can do giveaways and competitions, so definitely worth looking at that. Digital landscape is just blowing up, and I think every day you could add an extra icon here. A number of really populated websites and blogs. Again, every genre sort of has its own. There's some others that are really Australian specific, but a lot of the things that you need to be doing is research, and the shortcuts there are that there's these sites where if you just spend a few months kind of getting into them, you're going to start to get a feel for the types of places bands are playing, the types of bands that aren't Australian that are touring, and I think this can be a really good resource. Going backwards, sorry. Different music directories available, different online directories available, all of this we can get to you, but again, we're just trying to give you the cliff notes and the cheat sheet version of how to find the information that you need if you're serious about coming into Australia. Industry associations, for every acronym you have, we have. APRA is a songwriting collecting society, you have SOCAN. We have ARIA, you have CREA, and so on and so forth. So it's worth knowing what those industry associations do for you here. They do for the Australians back home, but there's also quite a good relationship between each of the sister societies, so there's always opportunities there as a resource to look for help. Certainly the Association of Artists Managers are working more and more closely with the MMF in Canada, and I know AIR and SEMA are in a lot of conversations. So I think that in terms of building an infrastructure around what artists and managers are doing independently is really worth acknowledging. We have a series of showcase conference events throughout the year, and pretty much every state has a key event. And I will actually just acknowledge that Big Sound, which is, I would suggest, our premier event, it takes place in September, and they've just announced an opportunity for a Canadian act to be selected to showcase there. So that's coming up, and it literally was announced within the last few hours. So if you jump onto that early, it's worth taking a look at. And we can come back to a bunch of this stuff. This is the one of visa, tax and immigration, so we might get to that later. So that's just to give you folks just an idea of the sort of stuff that's in the resource, and also hopefully a very, very rush, but we are very limited for time, and I'd rather get stuck into these people's heads. So I'm going to start with you, Geoff. You wear a number of hats.
Yes.
Venue booker, concert promoter, booking agent.
Mm-hmm.
We're only going to focus on your live side of your world for now.
Yep.
In each of those varying capacities, you've brought in artists.
Yep.
So you've toured different Canadian artists doing some one way, some another. Can you just maybe talk us through, I guess, Dan Mangan, Harrah's at a dual barber?
Yep.
First off, I wanted a little bit about those examples, 2 hours traffic and the approach that was taken with them, and then certainly the residency just recently with the trees, I think, are some good examples of the way you've been involved, but also reflect and demonstrate different ways Canadian artists have started to come into Australia.
Okay. Hey Rosetta, we discovered here at the ECMAs quite a few years ago, and so we decided that we're going to take the punt and do a tour on their own back. So we anchored we pitched at a festival called Peach Ridge Festival, and then anchored that as the crux of the tour. And then we also did Woodford, which was amazing for the band. And I do believe there was quotes in the press that there was the highlight of Woodford that year.
I'll send that to you.
And then we put out the record. And at that stage of when we started touring, we only had the label. It was like the second release of the label, which we predominantly did just to help out with the touring.
Right.
So, and since then, I mean, we did that one tour, and the band's so big, it took a long time to get back into the market, but we played some successful venues, and we created enough of a buzz that we kept working on it, and they just were in Sydney recently, where they managed to get the City of Colour tour, and now they last tour they just played to multiple nights of 1500 all
so
around the country.
You said you had a release. Did the release come first? Did you release the Hey Rosetta CD into the market?
Or no,
it was in tandem of them arriving.
It was in tandem of them. It was actually the release was set up purely to get press for the tour.
Okay, and was that the same story with Jill Barber, Dan Mangan?
With Jill, again, we saw it here at the ECMAs.
It's a good event, right?
Yeah. And we actually set up the release way before the tour.
Okay.
And with Jill, we brought her out solo, and then we brought her out with her brother Matthew, and they sort of did back-to-back. And then we brought her out again and pitched her a swap tour with an artist back in Australia called Geoff Lang.
Okay.
And so she toured all around Australia. We released her first album, and then the next album I pitched it at a major and did a deal with ABC, and they released Chances. And then another tour happened, and we kept building and building and building. And the last tour, the press just went crazy on Jill, and we really pushed the press angle, and we're getting full pages in the Sydney Morning Herald, and we've gone from an act that no one really knew to where she's selling, you know, 200 seaters on her own. Yeah.
And is that because you looked at her and just knew inherently the Australian market? Like, what, when you're looking at the bands that are showcasing here, what is it about them that you think this will work in Australia? Like, what are the sort of some of the signals?
She had great songs, and she had a great live show, you know, and I think that's the basis of what's going to work in most territories. But there was something a bit unique about Jill, just how she performed and her songwriting, and you could just see from release to release to release that she was just always developing where she was going with her music. And I found that sort of had a really good connection with Australia.
The Trues, I guess, is the most recent example.
The Trues they're going really well in Australia. It's like we're really kicking home. The last 2 days we've been getting emails overnight that they just got high rotation on the commercial Triple M market, which is pretty much near impossible for even an Australian band to get, let alone a Canadian band. And then we just got news today that one of the big TV stations is going to use their new single as the theme song, Channel 10, for the next 2 months.
Wow.
So
the thing, though, that you did with that, you set up a residency, which I guess takes a big commitment for a band. And look, admittedly, the Trues are probably in a position financially where they could back themselves in a way that perhaps emerging and first-time exporters aren't. But what was it you did with those guys?
Well, we took them over, we anchored on a conference, which was the One Movement in Perth,